Hi, I'm John Babcock with Georgia Actors, here with Jason Warner Smith. Thanks for having us out here.
Yeah.
It's very nice.
Oh, thank you.
Wanted to ask you, what was your kind of first experience that made you decide to pursue acting?
So when I was 9 years old, growing up in Cobb County, Georgia here, my mother and some other ladies in the 70s formed a group called the Cobb County Arts Alliance, I believe was the name of it. And so they wanted to get their kids some culture, so to speak. And had drama classes for their kids. And at the end of drama class, we would put on a play. And the very first play was the musical children's theater story of Chester the Cricket. And I played the Chinese man who sold the cricket to the boy. And it was a lot of fun. I enjoyed it. I was no good at sports, and I was seemed to be better at this, and so I just kept doing that one play a year for a while, and then they started doing an older group for teens called the Cobb Teen Theater Company. I did that every summer until I was like almost 20. I was getting a little too long in the tooth, and then moved to Georgia. I was at Georgia State, did theater there, and it just kept going. I've never found more pleasure than I find being in a group or a company of creative people in a dark, cold room on a beautiful summer day, you know?
Yeah, I know what you mean.
And that's just, I don't know, I enjoy the rehearsal process of theater almost more than I enjoy performing it. Not exactly, but close to it. I like both.
Yeah, is it because of the exploration and the discovery and the creativity?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I wasn't thinking that when I was a kid, like, ooh, yes, this creativity is amazing. It's just, it's fun. And that's what it's always been. And there's been a time in my life when I completely dropped out of acting because I was doing other things with my life and thought, okay, it's just a hobby. You know, I'll do it when I have time to get my rocks off or whatever, but I need to concentrate on, like, how am I going to pay for things the rest of my life? And so I moved out of it for a while. But I couldn't stay away and got right back into it. Matter of fact, the first play that I did, we were talking about this earlier, before y'all were here.
Right.
My first play back after a long hiatus was Essential Theater with Peter Hardy. We did a play called Ice Glen, and that's when my wife's like, "You're going to do what? You're going to be at rehearsal 4 nights a week, and for how long? And you're not going to be, you know." It was a crash course for her, but that's why I just love performing. I I've talked about this before. I really enjoy working in film and television because, A, it pays really well, and you get to do really cool things. But there's nothing like the theater. If they paid me the kind of money they pay me to do film and TV, and all I did was theater, all I would do is theater. It's they're the same thing, but it's just so different.
Yeah.
So such a different experience for the actor.
Well, that was also one of my questions too. Is how do you approach a character or a role on camera versus on stage? Do you have different ways of approaching that, or is it kind of similar?
It's a timeline kind of thing, because with theater you have so much time to work on whatever. With film and TV, it's just boom, go. You know, I mean, when I was on The Walking Dead, I remember having a panic attack because I finally got my first big scene, and it was 10 pages, and I got the script 2 days before we shot. But for a play, you've got a month of rehearsals, of discovery, finding things, and hanging out with these cool people, and then, of course, opening night, and you get an audience, you get instant feedback, and you never get feedback in film and TV. So back to your question, how do I prepare differently? I don't prepare any differently, I just have to do it faster for film and TV. And there is, I mean, in rare exceptions, but for my experience, there's no rehearsal for film and TV. None. They expect you to show up and deliver. I mean, there's like a rehearsal before you shoot.
Right.
But there's no week-long, let's discover together. That just doesn't happen in film and TV. It does, but not at my level.
You do a lot of, and have been in a lot of short films.
Recently, I have been, All of the shorts that I've been in, I have not created as a writer. The most recent one that's about to come out, called Chipper, I didn't write, but I instigated it happening. I'm the executive producer, the lead actor, and money finder, and all that.
Hey, Dad. I need to ask you some questions. Hello?
Is this still the Walker residence?
Yes. He sleeps most of the day. They feed him, bathe him, change his catheter.
Did you ask Adeshawa to send me this?
Why are you making him do this?
All that shit that happened just makes it good. Oh,
yeah.
No, you know what it says in this letter? No, you know what it says?
What does it say in the goddamn letter?
Fuck!
Is that true?
But the other short films I've been involved in, whether they're the ones with Cameron Schwartz, I've done three with him, and the other folks that I've worked with, I'm not going to get the names right, so I'm not going to try to remember them all right now. They came to me. You know, some I just blindly auditioned for off of a Facebook post because I'm like, I'm bored, I want to do something. The short films for me give me something to do between the big projects.
Okay.
And I'm still working on camera, and I'm meeting people in the community, and I'm, you know, I'm getting to know people like you guys, you know, that make other projects, and I just enjoy it because it's short. Mm-hmm. You know, you shoot the whole thing in a weekend usually, or maybe two, and then it's over, which is a double-edged sword. I love working with Cameron Schwartz. I made a movie called Northfield with him, a movie named Rest Stop with him, and another one is called The Formula. And they're all short little films. Some are proof of concepts and different things like that. Mm-hmm. And while I'm working with him, and I'm also working with Steve Coulter on all of these projects, Randy Havens was in one of them, and I enjoyed working with all of them, but it's just over so soon.
Right.
That's the part about film and TV that I don't like, is it just doesn't last very long. Whereas theater, you know, it's a couple of months at least.
Yeah, yeah.
You get to hang out with these people.
Yeah, and the short actually helps, you know, kind of newer actors in the industry get some face time.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah, for newer actors, that is the gold standard. You know, get involved with Emory, SCAD, whomever, you know, that are a student. I'm talking about student films.
Right.
And other people, independent makers of short films. I mean, we all have a camera in our pocket now.
Right.
For an actor who's trying to build their resume, trying to build their reel, trying to build their network of people, the short film market, and this, especially in the Atlanta area, is that's the way to go.
How would you say you combat the kind of the maybe the discouragement that you as an actor may have felt in your career where things were?
I'm going to boil this down to process versus product.
Okay.
That's how I deal with it. And I tell my students this all the time. You've got to be in love with the process. If you're only in it for the product, you're going to go insane.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sitting around waiting for the email to come in for your audition and then waiting to see if you booked it and doing nothing else that has something to do with your artistic drive in the rest of the time that you have, which is most of your time,
right.
You're going to go insane. And if it's all about, I succeeded in this you know, I got the product, I made it. What's next? As soon as that's over, there's nothing except the process. And the process is being in class, working with friends, going to see theater, going to see movies, watching TV, studying, practicing. If you don't enjoy practicing the art of acting, then it's just gonna be a horrible existence for someone who wants to pursue this. So you have to buoy yourself with process and living and enjoying everything about it.
Mm-hmm.
And I tell my students, it's like, if you don't like coming to class, if you're not enjoying being here, you should quit. Be an accountant. Find something else to do. This is not for you. So.
What about when you felt, as an actor, enough, maybe that a sense of confidence that, okay, I think I know what I'm doing. Or has that ever happened? I know, you know, you could see something and feel like you know what you're doing, but then watch somebody do something else. You're like, I don't know what I'm doing in this business at all.
The greatest compliment I have gotten so far as an actor was when my good friend Rob Mello came to see the Laramie project that we did at Theatrical Outfit. And the next day we were talking on the phone, or he texted me. I don't remember exactly how we communicated. And he just said, I was watching you and I just thought, he's reached some new level of fuck it that I don't understand. And that was like the nicest thing that anyone's ever said to me about my acting. I tell my students this, I keep referring to them because mm-hmm. they're learning. You become inured to things after a while, and it's called having faith. You have confidence and faith in your abilities. For those of us who got to drive when they were 16, that first month or so, you're a nervous wreck, but then it's like breathing. Acting's no different. And once you've kind of experienced all of the different possible unknowns a couple of times, then you should be fine. You know, once you've done that live in-person audition with some tough casting director a couple of times and you were nervous and you were maybe a little less nervous, but you eventually like, okay, I got this. If you stick with it and you continue to grow any kind of nerves or problems you're going to have, and not having faith in yourself mm-hmm. will go away because you know you can do it. I've been here. I've seen this. There's nothing new.
Well, speaking of that, you spent some time in L.A. for a number of years, did you know?
Yeah, I was there 91, 2, and 3.
Okay.
I was there learning that I didn't belong there.
Well, yeah, I sort of asked what did you glean from there and what made you come back?
I went out there because I had zero responsibility at that particular moment in my life. I did have a girlfriend, sorry, Angie. And left her behind. She broke it off smartly, very shortly thereafter. Anyway, I went out there and I knew no one. Mm-hmm. I went out there, I had a hookup through my sister with a roommate, and I lived there with this person for like 6 months, and then I met the people that are still the best friends of my life now. And I lived in that community for 2.5 years. Mm-hmm. What I learned is that I was completely ill-prepared. I didn't have the skills. I didn't have the resume. I didn't know what I was doing. Mm-hmm. But it was a good way to learn it. It was a great way to learn it the hard way. I finally, after like 2.5 years, I finally got an agent. Mm. This is like a lower level agent. And I immediately got an audition for Star Trek Next Generation. Mm-hmm. And then I got an audition for the movie California with a K. I went to the... I went to the Star Trek audition on the Paramount lot, you know, and it was one of the time travel ones. It's like the 1800s or something uh-huh. like that. And I'm like this reporter, cub reporter in the 1800s or whatever. And I got my little tweed coat on and everything. And I meet in the casting director's office. I don't know who that was. I wish I did. And she's like, that was great. Come back at 3 o'clock and do that again. Enjoy the lot while you're here. And I'm wandering around the lot and I'm seeing Klingons and like, this is it. This is it. This is the day that my career begins. I'm going to be on Star Trek Next Generation. And I walk into my callback, and there's 11 people in there in suits and stuff in this big old room. And I'm like, ah. And I did my audition. And then the next morning, my agent calls, and this is like, what happened? That's what they, not what happened. It was like, what happened? I'm like, it went great. It was fantastic. And this. No. He goes, that's not what I heard. What? He goes, yeah, they said you were awful. You were the greenest actor they'd ever seen. And I'm just like, oh, my God. And then I had the California audition. It didn't go well either, and they dropped me like that. I had an agent for a week. That's L.A. Now, that was a long time ago. It was 93. But that's the difference between that kind of a market and here. Mm-hmm. You don't hear that story here. They give people a chance here for a while. But out there, at that particular time in history, deliver or you're gone. Mm-hmm. And I completely screwed it up because I wasn't ready. I wasn't ready. Mm-hmm.
If you had,
and then I moved back.
And then you moved back.
Actually, I was working at Agatha's Mystery Dinner Theater.
Oh, okay.
The year prior to moving there.
Okay.
And due to a long story, they said, hey, man, you wanted your job back at Agatha's? I'm like, yes, I'm on my way. And I moved back here, and I went to work at Agatha's for 3 more years.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Is it necessary now for Georgia actors to make that move at all, do you think? Or is there enough...
To Los Angeles?
Yeah, or New York or Chicago or anything like that.
That's a question that I wish I knew the answer to. Mm-hmm. I have some ideas around it because that's me.
Right.
After I finished my second season of The Walking Dead, I was pretty hot. My star had risen pretty high. You know, it's like, this is as hot as I've ever been. Now's the time. And I started pulling in all my favors, like, hey, I'd like to talk to Paradigm, Performing Artists Agency, Endeavor, all the mm-hmm. that second tier, top tier type agencies that my friends on The Walking Dead were with.
Right.
Crickets, nothing. It's just, you got to be there. Mm-hmm. And they were all like, are you going to live here? I'm like, no, we live in Atlanta, and I got frequent flyer miles. I'm like, all right. But I mean, I couldn't even get interviews. So mm-hmm. I have an agent out there now, and it was through a connection. I had someone who's with them who said, this is Jason, you should, and that's how it works. So is it necessary for Atlanta actors to go to LA or New York? Let me answer your question. No. Not if you want to be a regular everyday working actor and okay. not trying to be a series regular on a sitcom or a series regular on a, you know, like right off the bat, then no, just stay here for now. I don't want more people moving here. So yeah, the air is really bad, the traffic sucks, it's terrible, don't come. No.
Do you think that the roles for Georgia actors, Georgia working actors, are getting better in some of these features and television shows?
It is, slowly but surely. Again, I can only speak for myself, but mm-hmm. you know, I am getting more opportunities for, you know, guest stars, recurring guest stars, major guest stars. So it's a little bit better every year. I think the frustration that most actors in this market face is they watch TV and they're like, it's the same actors over and over again. Why am I not getting an opportunity to play that part? I could play that part. You probably could. But you don't recognize you. You recognize them. Mm-hmm. It's a business. So, yes, there's more and more of the bigger roles for TV and bigger roles for film as well. And I'm seeing friends now start to book those. And it's going to happen. Somebody's just going to get lucky and, like, first one out the chute, they book that big thing. But most of the time, it's putting in the hours of auditions, because every audition is an audition for the role you're auditioning for and to get the next audition. That's the process. And you prove yourself in the co-star roles, you prove yourself, and you move up, and people would say, okay, we can trust this person. It really comes down to that. I was offered two roles this year that I did not have to audition for. One for Candy on Hulu, because I worked with Michelle Purple and Jessica Biel on a film 6 years ago, and they remembered me. Mm. And they just said, oh, we're going to Atlanta. We need to get Jason a part. That's literally, they told me that's how it happened, and it's never happened like that before. So it can happen. It just takes time.
Yeah.
That was 6 years between this point point. I didn't know that was going to happen. They didn't say, in 6 years, we'll be back to give you this role. Now. Nothing. I mean, even on The Walking Dead, you didn't even know if you were going to be in the next season or the next episode.
Right.
Josh Michael would get it, and I would get our scripts and go, dude, we're not dead. All right. We got a chance, you know.
Still in it.
Yeah, they haven't killed us. We might fall in a hole somewhere, but we're not dead.
Richard will refrain from attending our future exchanges.
Oh, Ezekiel, you're going to keep bringing him. Because if this doesn't stop, if this starts becoming a real problem, you remember what I said. He is still batting first on the lineup. I almost did it myself just now.
Hey.
I know it's not his fault, but this has got to stop. So, things might need to get a little visceral. Jared, get the hell up! Let's get the hell out of here.
But yeah, let's touch on your teaching. When did you feel that you had enough of an ability to teach? Mm-hmm. Did that come with age? Did that come with kind of credentials that you've built up? You know, when did you get the point where like, okay, I think I can offer something?
I think it's both. Mm-hmm. And honestly, I was pushed by two different people that I love very much. The first being Sandra Dorsey, who is retired now, and she taught Strasburg here in Atlanta for 30, 35 years. We're still in touch. She's still around. Mm-hmm. She's just not teaching anymore. Fabulous actress. And she said, Jason, it's time for you to teach. And she was basing that on the fact of I was in her class and what I could do as an actor. And she taught Strasburg, and I was very, you know, she's like, you know what you're doing. You could teach this to someone now. And you have credentials. People will take you seriously because of your resume. Mm-hmm. And then in short order, not in this order, Rob was first, my good friend Rob Mello, who you've interviewed, also said the same thing. And we had just met. We were working on a play called Speed the Plow at Pinch and Ouch Theater. And he's like, dude, you should come teach. You should teach your Strasburg method over at my school where I teach Meisner. I'm like, Rob, you know, I don't know about that. But a year later, you know, he kept poking me and prodding me. And he finally convinced me. And that's when I started. And I sucked in the beginning and I got better. And I've been doing it for 8 years now. And I think I'm pretty good at it. People seem to think I'm doing a good job. Mm-hmm. I have some students that have been with me 5-6 years. I didn't have this epiphany. Other people kind of said, you should do this. Mm-hmm. And that it gave me permission to kind of go, all right, I'll give it a shot. And I'm glad I'm doing it.
Are you learning as much as the students?
Yeah, unfortunately, I'm not able to be in class, you know, because I'm busy teaching all the time. But I will say this from my perspective, from my personal witness, that mm-hmm. it improves my acting immeasurably by teaching, because I'm just witnessing the process over and over and over and watching the light bulbs come on and seeing the mistakes. And then, you know, it just, I don't know, it's through osmosis, but it definitely helps me.
And do you want to touch on what you were kind of telling us earlier about the method that you're using or the acting?
I teach Strasberg first, and mm-hmm. that's what my, you know, 30 years of experience at it. You know, if it was a martial art, I'm a black belt in Strasberg. But I've discovered, and other people are going to begin discovering this soon, if they haven't already, is the Nikolai Demidov School of Acting. They call it the school instead of the technique. It's just, okay. It's just a technical term. And he was one of Stanislavski's contemporaries. I don't have time to tell the whole story right here, but I discovered it during the pandemic. It blew my mind. I've never had anything excite me as much as this since I learned Strasberg. So I've thrown myself fully into it. And going back to the martial arts things, there's white belt as a beginner, blue belt's the next step up, mm-hmm. and up to black belt. But in a martial arts school, the blue belts teach the white belts. I'm a blue belt in Demidov, mm-hmm. so I can teach beginners. My students are absolutely loving it. Their auditions are easier, their auditions are better, their performances on set are better, they're booking more work now. And even the ones who are reluctant to learn this new method are like, it actually works, because it's so simple and easy. It takes all the work out of it. It almost feels like you're cheating. Hmm. It feels like you're cheating when you're using Demidov. And I can't wait to tell more and more people about it. Okay. Eventually, I will be certified teacher by the Demidov Academy, but that's not going to be for 3 years or so. So in that time, Andre, if you see this, I'm sorry, but that's what I'm doing, buddy.
Finally, what advice can you give to those watching who are thinking of becoming an actor?
First thing I will say is, in the film and television industry, being an extra is something everyone should do to learn how the set works, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. but it is not a pathway to becoming an actor. It may get you excited about acting, but it is not a pathway. Mm-hmm. The most important advice I can give to anyone who's serious about becoming an actor is to get into a very good class and train, and not even leave to go outside and get an agent, a headshot, an audition for 2 years. And then if you still like acting, mm-hmm. then do that, because you may end up hating it.
Right.
Because if you hate class for 2 years, you're not going to be an actor. Plain and simple. There you go. I did it in less than 3 or 4 minutes.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Jayson, thank you.
Thank you. This was very painless and went by very fast.
It did go by very fast.
And we didn't have to talk about what Negan was thinking about that thing on that thing.
No, we don't have to.
Most interviews are like that. So you're with Jeffrey Dean Morgan.